Elders, brothers and sisters, salamu alaikum and good evening to you all. Tonight, we shall be having a talk on mental health well-being, where we have a guest speaker, Faheem Uddin. Faheem is lead governor and service user governor for Birmingham and Solihull Mental Health Foundation Trust. Faheem was initially a service user and started volunteering with the trust from 2003. And in 2013, he was elected as lead governor. Faheem also chairs the Positive Mental Health Group, where he has dedicated his service in helping other service users with any mental health related queries by signposting them in the right direction. So essentially, Faheem is here today to share his trials, triumphs, and ultimately his journey to recovery. I would now like to welcome Faheem on the podium with the Nara Salawat.
Assalamu alaikum, my dear elders, sisters, brothers. Okay. Like I said, my name is Faheem Uddin. I am a service user with mental health problems. So the word service user is used to represent, to sort of describe patients. A lot of people who have mental health problems, they don't like being called patients, so they like being called service users. Some people like being called patients. So it's whatever people are happy with. That's what we call them. And I have been asked by Dr. Abbas and the lady who just spoke to come here and do a bit of a talk about mental health problems, the problems I had, and what help is there out there available for people. It's going to be a small talk. I mean, I could stand here and talk to you for the next 10 hours because I've got vast experiences. I've had mental health problems from a very young age. I've been having treatment now for 30 years, but for the last 14 years, I've been a volunteer. And I started volunteering in 2003 by just doing normal photocopying for people. And I worked my way up to becoming a service user governor. I'm in my ninth year, and then 3 years ago, I got elected as the lead governor. And basically what my role is, as a service user governor, I represent people who use mental health services. So we have about 40 to 60,000 people that Birmingham and Solihull Mental Health Trust treat over the years. So I represent all those service users. And the lead governor role is, so we are a foundation trust, and basically a foundation trust is, it has more power. The money that the government gives them that's left over, they don't have to give that money back. They can keep that money and spend it for the next year. And one of my jobs is that I appoint the chair of the trust and I appoint all the non-executive directors. So that's basically what I do. And I also run the group, like was mentioned, called the Positive Mental Health Group. And that group is there to try and remove stigma and discrimination attached to mental health, even now in 2017. In a lot of cultures, people don't want to talk about mental health. When I was first diagnosed having mental health problems, people were saying, oh, he's got jinn, he's possessed, you know. And my mom and dad, they took me all over Britain to try and, you know, remove those jinns from me. I knew at a very, very early age that I was ill. I wasn't possessed. I didn't have any jinns, but just to keep my mom and dad happy, I went everywhere they wanted me to go. And then a few years ago, they finally accepted that, yes, our son is mentally ill. I started having mental health problems from a very young age. I was talking to Dr. Abbas earlier on. I mean, people, you read books, you read research, and people say, oh, these problems start when you're 13 years old, when you're 14 years old. Believe it or not, my first episode of psychosis was when I was 5 years old. I mean, doctors can't believe that, you know, but I sort of became ill when I was 5 years old first. And then for the next 10 years, my parents kept on taking me to the GP every 2 weeks, and the GP kept on sending me back home saying, there's nothing wrong, there's nothing wrong. I suffered like that for 10 years, and eventually, I decided to change GP, so I went to see a new GP. He sent me to hospital to have some physical tests done to rule out any physical illnesses, and then he sent me to have a psychiatric assessment. And when I had my assessment, they came back and said, yes, he is mentally ill. And I was talking to Dr. Abbas earlier on. In those days, you know, in the 80s, I don't want to give my age away, but in the 80s, we didn't have much of a camp service. Camp service is child and adolescent mental health services, or services for children. And I was put in a place called Rubri Hill, and I think I was the youngest person there. I mean, Rubri Hill was a horrible place. It was maybe slightly bigger than this hall, and it was jam-packed with patients. There was men there, women there, people a lot older than myself, people shouting, people screaming. I was there for 3 months, and I banned all visits. I said, I'm not going to have any visitors. My mom begged me not to ban the visits, but I said, no, I cannot have my mom and dad come and visit me in a place like this. But mashallah, we have come a long way since those days. Things have changed, things have improved. Yes, with the positive mental health group, I was talking to Dr. Abbas earlier on, and I find there's about 12, 13 events that happen in Birmingham and Solihull throughout the year. And my group try to attend all those events and hand out information. So if it's like Eid Mela, we'll target the Muslim community. If it's something to do with Afro-Caribbean community, we'll target that community. So we have literature. And what I find is with the English community, the white English-speaking community, they are more accepted of mental health problems now. They can openly talk about things. With the black community, they are starting to do those things. They are starting to talk. In our community, you know, Indian, Pakistani, it is difficult. We have made some strides, but it's still a taboo subject. You know, people don't want to discuss it. People want to hide it away. People think once you are diagnosed with a mental health problem, that's it, your life is over. I was told that my life was over. But like I said, we move so far now. If someone is diagnosed with having a mental health problem these days, at their first appointment when they see their psychiatrist, they also discuss their recovery, because at the end of the day, people do recover. Different stages to recovery. I mean, some people think when you recover, at the end of it, you will have a big house, a big car, money in the bank, you know, big job. No, recovery means different things to different people, and different people recover at different speeds. So if someone, I always use an example, if someone who likes to write poems, or maybe, I don't know, stories, and they become ill and they stop writing those poems, they stop writing those stories, and then once they start writing those stories again, that is their recovery. My last serious episode of illness was in 2002 when I became unwell and I stayed in home, in my bedroom, for 18 months. I did not leave the house. It was hard, but by this time I was married, and I am proof to you. I mean, I'm married, I have 2 children, I've been married, mashallah, for 22 years. I have a 19-year-old daughter who's doing biomedical sciences. She just passed her first year. My son is 13. He messes about a lot, but I'm hoping that he will follow his sister's example. So being diagnosed with a mental health problem, it is not the end of the world. It's a journey, and every step of the way, I mean, sometimes it is difficult, but you will recover. For me, being able to come out the house now, for me, being able to stand in front of people and talking to people, that is my recovery. Okay, I'm not doing paid work, I'm doing voluntary work, but sometimes I put in more hours than people who actually get paid. Because I've had treatment for 30 years, I want to put something back. So that's why for the last 14 years, I've been volunteering and representing other people. Like I said, people do feel embarrassed. I mean, for years and years, my parents would not tell anyone that I had mental health problems, only close family. So my brothers, my sister, they knew they had mental health problems. Whenever there was a wedding or a birthday party and I couldn't go to it because I wasn't feeling mentally well, because I also get migraines, my family always said, oh, he's got migraine, he's got a migraine. So I got away with it. But when I became ill again in 2002 for 18 months, people outside started finding out, oh, he's mentally ill, he's mentally ill. And when I came out of my breakdown, when I finally recovered, well, was able to leave the house, I found that all these friends that I had, the people that I would have died for, they all disappeared. And that's when I realized my mom and my dad, they weren't ashamed of me or they weren't embarrassed because I had mental health problems, but they knew how the community would react to me having mental health problems. But like I said, mashallah, I am married, I have 2 children, and I don't know where they get their brains from. It's certainly not from me, but They are doing well, and there is a life out there for people. The worst thing that can happen if you are diagnosed with mental health problems is suffering in silence. You could be surrounded by people sometimes. I used to love watching football. I support Liverpool, and I went to Liverpool so many times to watch them play. And I could be standing there in with 40,000 people, and I felt totally alone. And the worst thing that can happen is you suffer in silence. There is help out there. If you ever think that you are experiencing some difficulties or you know someone that might be, your first step is to go to your GP. See your GP, tell your GP how are you feeling. And then it's the GP's job to refer you to other services. It might be medication, so you might see a psychiatrist, or it might be talking therapies where you just need to talk about your problems, where you might see a psychologist. Are you happy for me to carry on, or are you bored? Carry on, okay. So like I said, I don't know what's more scary, standing in front of you today, because I also do the trust induction for where I volunteer in Birmingham and Solihull. So we have 40 to 60,000 people that we treat each year, and we have 4,500 staff that work for the trust. And every month, twice a month, 30 to 40 new people join the trust, and I have to stand in front of them and talk for 2 hours. And some of them are doctors, some of them are nurses, they are chief executives, executive directors. So I don't know which is more scary, standing in front of them or standing in front of you today here. And so that's sort of my story. Like I said, I could carry on for days and days. And things that happen, you know, sometimes someone might say to you, oh, I just heard something, do you hear that? For that person who's hearing the voices, it's a real thing. So I always say to people, if someone says to you, oh, I just heard this voice, did you hear it? If you haven't heard it, say no, you didn't hear it. Because if you say to the person, yes, I did hear it, they might be trying you out and they're gonna think you're lying. But what I always say to people, if someone says to me, oh, I just heard a voice, or I just saw something, did you hear it? I would say to them, no, I didn't see it, I didn't hear it, but I believe you heard it, you saw it. So it's just giving those people that sort of confidence. Like I said to you, people say that your first episode of psychosis is when you're 13, 14. I was 5 years old, I was playing outside in the garden, and I saw a man sitting by the fence down the garden, and I screamed, and my mom came running out the house, out the kitchen, and she said, what is it, what is it? And I said, mom, can you see that man sitting there? My mom looked, my mom said, there's no one there. As I'm looking at you right now, the man got up, he looked at me, he walked towards the fence, he didn't even open the door, he walked through the fence. I saw all that, my mom didn't see it. So for me, it was real. So people that have mental health problems, some people see things, some people hear things, some might be in the extreme, you know, psychosis. For some, it might be just something, minor depression. So I know a lot of people who had depression in the past, and they have a treatment, maybe 6 months of treatment, and they get better and off they go, mashallah. And some people like myself might be there for the long term. The doctors can't take my illness away from me. They told me that, you know, years ago. What they can do is help me with medication to try and control my symptoms. So what happens now is I might have a good week, I might have a good 2 weeks, might have a good 3 weeks, then I might have a bad period. It might be 3 days, it might be 2 weeks, it might be 3 weeks. But thankfully, mashallah, that when I become ill now, I don't have to stay at home for 18 months. I stayed at home for 18 months, you know, without leaving the house. That was a horrible time for me and my family. But now, because I've got all these meetings to go to, I'm standing in front of you today talking, you know, I have to get out the house and I have to go to those meetings. I mean, this week's been quite bad for me. I've had an infection and I've not gone to any meetings this week. I've sent my apologies, but Dr. Abbas kindly and the lady who announced me, they invited me to come and talk here. And I said, it doesn't matter how I feel, I am gonna go inshallah and give this little talk. I mean, I'll just stop at this point and see if anyone got any questions. Anyone wants to ask any questions? I had an uncle in Pakistan who had epilepsy. But in Pakistan, he had epilepsy and people used to treat him like, oh, he's mad. So every time he had an epileptic attack, they used to tie him up with chains. You know. So my mom, even now, my father doesn't like psychiatrists. He goes, the medication they give you, they make you sleepy, they make you drowsy, you know. So he won't accept that. But my mom accepted, but my mom passed away 9 years ago. But I feel she was the only person in the family who really understood my problems, you know. And mashallah, I'm very lucky that my daughter, you know, she understands what I'm going through. I tried to hide it before. I didn't want to let them know because they were children. But it's difficult. How can you hide it? If you're living in the same house as someone, how can you hide your problems? So my daughter understands, my wife understands, and my son is trying to understand, but I don't want to put my son under pressure because he's only 13 years old. Yes? I'm glad you asked me that question, because when people were diagnosed with having mental health problems in the old days, the only thing people used to treat was their mental health problems. They used to forget about the physical health. And now we are spreading the message that, look, when you're treating someone with mental health problems, please don't forget about their physical problems. For years and years, even any medication you take, something simple like paracetamol, it had side effects. But the medication you take for your mental health problems, as Dr. Abbas will know, have a lot of side effects. So for years, I begged my GP to do blood pressure tests, to do blood tests, and he said no. Eventually, in 2005, he decided to do my blood pressure, and he found out I had high blood pressure. So now I'm on blood pressure tablets. Then they found out I had high cholesterol. So now I'm on cholesterol tablets. Then they found out I had non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. So I'm on medication for that. And 5 years ago, they found out I am also diabetic. So I'm on medication for diabetes. And the doctors had a meeting, and they had to weigh it. What do I want to do? If I stop taking my mental health medication, I won't be able to function properly. I'll just stay at home. If I carry on taking the medication, my side effects might get worse, but at least I'll be able to go to the house. So I have blood tests every 3 months, and they are trying to control my physical problems. So mashallah, my last blood test showed that my diabetes is under control. It's taken me 5 years to get there, but thankfully now it's under control. I just got to make sure that I watch what I eat and, you know, how I sort of live my life. Smoking is really bad, but I smoke, you know. I've been told to give up. I just can't give up smoking. I can give up anything else, but not smoking. Yes, this person that's back. Hopefully by telling my story and you know, by spreading the word, by going to as many events as I can, but I can't do it on my own. I need all of you here to help me. I need everyone from Birmingham and Solihull Mental Health Trust to help me, because it's everyone's business, you know, fighting stigma, fighting discrimination. I'll give you one example. About 6-7 years ago, I don't know if you are familiar with the Zinnia Hospital on Shaul Green Lane. You know Zinnia? So when the Zinnia was being planned, there was a lot of opposition. People were holding petitions. They were saying, you can't build this here. You can't build this in our community. We had meetings with the local community. The chip shop that's just down the road, I said to them, I said, why are you having a petition? If the hospital opens, you'll have a better business because people are going to come to your chip shop. So they stopped the petition. They stopped it. They ripped it up and threw it away, you know? Yeah, so we had a little model of the Zinnia Hospital, which we took to Eid Mela in Cannon Hill Park. And there was two ladies who approached, and they said, there was one lady, I think she was in her 60s, and one was in her 50s. And the 61 asked the 51, what is that? And so she asked me in Punjabi and Urdu, and I was explaining to her. I said, it's a new hospital we are building. This is where the doctors are going to sit. This is going to be the car park. I spent 15 minutes telling her what it is. And then the elder one asked her, what did he say? And she looks at her and she goes, he said, Paglandi Hospital. And I looked and I thought, I spent 15 minutes telling you what it is, and at the end of it, all you can say is, Baglandi Hospital. Another thing I used to do, when I used to stand in the stall and people asked me if I had mental health problems, I always said no. Because you always get some clever people who are going to say to you, oh, what's your diagnosis? What medication you're taking? Then I always say to them, are you a doctor or a nurse? No, I'm not. But then I'm not going to tell you my diagnosis because you can't do anything for me. Last 3-4 years, when I'm standing on the stall and if someone asks me if I'm having mental health problems, I say yes. Because I'm thinking, if I'm honest with these people, if I'm, you know, open about it, they will go and get the help they need. I mean, I'm standing in front of you today. I mean, have I got horns or, you know, is anything different? Huh? Any other questions? You know, that when they say ignorance is the worst thing, you know, every time I've had a diagnosis, because over the years my diagnosis have changed so many times, I go out, I do research, I find out exactly what the diagnosis means, you know. And having discussions like this, that's how you're going to educate people, you know. And we worked really hard. Another thing that we've done and I'm really proud of is we have worked really hard with the police in the West Midlands. So we have a thing called street triage. So what normally happened, if someone was in trouble, the police used to turn up, that person might be having mental health problems, the police didn't know, and they used to take them to the police station and put them in the cell. Now we have a special vehicle that has a police officer, a doctor, a paramedic, and a nurse. It's called street triage. So if they are called to an incident, they will turn up. The doctor will assess that person to see whether this person is mentally ill. And if they find this person is having mental health issues, they will either take him to their home and give him an appointment to see someone the next day. They will take him to a place called a place of safety, which is a hospital, or they might take him to a general hospital. In the last year, the police were called out 1,200 times and not one person ended up in a police station. Out of 1,200, not one person ended up in a police cell. Because if you're having mental health problems and you also end up in a police station, that's going to make your problems even worse. Okay, I think that's the end of my talk. So thank you for listening and being patient. So, assalamu alaikum.
It's much more. Faheem, I just want to say thank you for your insight into your journey. And I think your insight and your story is much more powerful than what any professional can give. And I think that's the most influential thing for our community to start raising awareness of mental health. Thank you. Salawat.